It's Sunday. I'm running late, but that's okay. Today's carnival. My son was in the carnival parade. My wife wanted to see him, and she picked him up. I like to have lunch with everybody before I come train, so ate quite late. I am still doing all my normal warm-ups and chewing gum and my coffee. I'm learning to drink coffee. Espresso freddo, double. No sugar, no milk, just ice. Double espresso. So I'm here at the gym. Today is week three of the three-week wave. Get my gum out. It's going to drive you guys crazy. Today is week three, or week one, actually, however you want to look at it, of the three-week wave of training that I do. If you follow along with my training, basically week one in the program, which is where I'm at, is a week to focus on weaknesses and let the body recover a little bit from being banged up in general training. Week two is repeated singles against something that requires you to be fast, bands or chains, usually some sort of extreme amount of bands or chains. But it's I may have up to 60-65% on the bar and just a crap ton of bands pulling repeated singles. But I'm trying to figure out technique. And the week after that, it is a max, pulling up to a single, generally with the same amount of bands or chains or the same setup that I used in week two. The plan in week two and three is to finish those weeks and have a great idea what your weaknesses are and how to improve them. Or at least know where your weaknesses are or have an understanding where you're beat up. So in week two last week, I discovered that if I take my feet and turn my heels in ever so slightly, I didn't mean ever so slightly, that I can wedge myself into position better. I can use more quads, more hams. I get a better arch, more speed, better off the floor, better transition in the middle, and a better lockout. And I made that transfer over into the max week last week. So I need to come into this week and continue to build on that, make sure I can find my technique consistently from a better position. I'm pulling almost always in the rack. You don't have to pull in the rack. You can pull deficit from the floor. The idea is that you do something that focuses on making you better at your weak points. And, a big thing for me is I need to recover. My hips are beat up. My back's a little tight. Not just from deadlifts, but I'm also pushing squats, Atlas stone, sandbags, overhead press. All those things work on my hips a little bit. So being able every couple of weeks to come in here and have something where my hips, my spine, don't take quite as much of a beating, that's a big thing. So today I'm going to do these rack pulls here as normal. And then I know that my game plan is two hard sets of five with some slow negatives. And I'm going to do the front-loaded bands as well. So let's just get moving and start getting stuff set up. Somebody's been here. No joke, somebody's been here. Because that wasn't up there. Now, I know I've been increasing the band tension on the front-loaded bands every week for the last few weeks. I'll go around here on the side here, load this. These front-loaded bands, I use this with clients if they're working on a car deadlift. You get it used to pulling in that backwards motion and kind of pushing out in front of you and leaning back a little more, not a row, but a row-esque movement. But for me, these allow me not only to force to use my hamstrings more, but I'm allowed to use my hamstrings more, and I'm allowed to lean back into the lift of my body weight a little more. That takes the pressure off your spine and puts it more onto your legs, hamstrings, and your muscles. That's really, really big, guys. I hope that makes sense. So, this is not – obviously, it's not a competition lift, but neither is a rack pull. Neither is using a squat bar, Neither is being in your home gym. You know, so I highly recommend these. And my plan this week is to go kind of stupid with the front-loaded band tension. I'm going to start with a single. These are a little bit more than a monster mini. These are between a monster mini and a light band. But I'm going to use, the plan is two sets of these. And then my red bands, which are somewhere between an average and a heavy band, over the top. That's the plan anyway. And not really, only a couple of plates. And then if I feel frisky, I'll take an extra single or something with, you know, extra plate or two. But I got to remember, I have to finish this week being a better deadlifter and feeling better and not as beat up as I have been. That way, I can go back into next week and hit those repeated speed deads again, those repeated singles, and make them super effective. And then, of course, tomorrow night, I want to load sandbags. So I know that if I don't get beat up tonight, I should be able to do something pretty good tomorrow night. First set is always fun with these. They're never even tension either till you get some reps in. Blind as a bat, so I can barely see where the grooves are on this bar. I keep a lot of lights in here, that way I can actually see things. Working on getting those heels in the right position. Add a second set in the top loaded bands. I don't know how much tension this is pulling forward. I know I've measured them before. But, you know, bands wear out. They get less and less tension. But the thing is, this is more than what I had a few weeks ago. This is beyond what I really need on these. But the next go-around, when I come back to these, I can use something less from the front. Maybe something less on the top. And use heavier straight weight. But, you know, hey, the idea from this is to make me a better normal deadlifter from the floor. So that doesn't always mean I have to go heavy here and that I have to continuously progress to wave heavy, light, heavy, light. I have to do whatever it takes to make me a better deadlifter from the floor. And sometimes that is a lot more complicated than just picking up weights from the floor or from the rack. It's about doing what you know you need to do to make yourself a better deadlifter. I can't see the bar. That's way out in front. Feet are cramping. A lot of calf work actually driving and pushing away. That'll change once I add more bands to the top and plates on there. I really thought I can sit here and talk with you guys today while training. I don't think I can do that here in a minute. I'm just going to have to turn the mics off and get my own little world like I normally do. I'm not for sure how people actually train while talking on the microphone to the camera. I mean, I talk to myself all the time when I train. I'm not really for sure what I say, but I'm sure. I know the thoughts are there. Last couple weeks I've come home from training. My wife will say, oh, how'd it go? Who all showed up? I said, wow, the gym was full. Really? Who came? Me, myself, and I. I was really just expecting me and myself. But when I showed up, things got wild. She always gets laughed. This is my last raw-ish set. It is a 50-pound squat bar, so it's thicker than a regular bar. It's thicker than a regular bar. Compare it to a deadlift bar, it's crazy thick, and it is bent. That's why I use it for squats, but why I use it for deadlifts on the rack here. So I hook grip this. Start feeling that switch. Start to switch. No idea how people talk. Those heels set where you want them. Come on. Whoa, that's fun. Whoa, that'll throw you forward. I may flip over today.
Honestly, something around here has been my work.
Sit there, I put my Spud Ink Gateway Briefs on. These are my single ply. These are the ones I normally keep at home. And I'll put these on off days just to squeeze and compress my quads, my upper thighs, glutes, hips, hip flexors. I can just wear them while I'm sitting at work for 30 minutes or an hour. And it compresses everything. May sound ridiculous, but it's absolutely amazing. The single ply are really, really easy to get on. And I put them on here for a heavier set of rack pulls. What I found with these Gateway Briefs, the two ply especially,
is that I can put them on top of my suit. And there's a lot of things. First of all, I can take my belt off in between sets, and my suit doesn't just completely slide down. It stays on, keeps my suit in place, but it provides a lot of compression. Not squeezing tight hard like a deadlift suit, but like a knee sleeve kind of compression on my quads, my hips, my glutes, as well as my abs. It's like wearing just a little bit of extra. I mean, I can pull these up more, but it is like a knee sleeve through your midsection as well. It's easy to slide on, easy to get up. And I like wearing these Spud Ink briefs. I like the 2-ply especially if I need to do a heavy or a hard rack pull from anywhere around mid-shin or a partial deadlift, something like that. Sometime when the number counts or if I'm a little beat up. Now, I've worn these for Atlas Stones for a long time because Atlas Stones, sandbags, things like that, they do eat into your hips badly, especially if you're training like for a personal record or a world record and you're doing stones twice a week, stones or sandbags twice a week. That loading motion really eats into your hips. And then you add in squats and deadlifts and any other events at the same time. These things are absolute magic. Performance-wise, do they help? Yes, I ain't lying. These things, I wouldn't wear them if they were just supportive and comfortable and fashion statements. Yeah, they absolutely do help you to lift more weight. But Clint, you can't wear them on meat day. Well, you know what? It's not meat day. You know what you also can't do on meat day? You can't do a rack pull. You can't use bands. You can't use chains. You can't use your own bars, your own plates at your own gym. And Def Leppard won't always be playing on the radio. You got to adapt and you got to make your training work for you. These Spud Ink briefs, I highly suggest them. The single ply for when you're just sitting around the house or if you're doing Atlas Stones or some kind of event like that where you need compression, but you need to be able to get a really great full range of motion. I've got my 2-plies over there. You see me wearing those on front squat day. If I was serious about having to move some serious weight today, I would have worn the 2-ply instead of the 1-ply. But I just wanted these on for a little bit of extra protection because again, my plan for today is to recover a little bit better so I can have a great training session tomorrow and so that I can go into the next 2 weeks of my deadlift training cycle recovered. So the point of today is to get in here, learn something, reinforce what I've learned over the last couple of weeks, focus on my weak points, and recover a little better than I have the last couple of weeks. So that's what I did. Knocked out a couple sets of fives, took a heavier double, and then came and took this last set on the end with the Spud Ink briefs on. These things are absolutely great. Highly suggest them. And they look so sexy, you can wear them to the mall. Let's get moving, guys.
At least a solid 3 here. Not killing myself on pressing. Need to let the shoulder feel a little bit better after the day that it has. So this is a good solid set of 3-5 is the plan, but just a fun set of 3 would be fine without smashing my microphone. Thank you. Let's go. Let's go. That's good. That's all right. Feel that pec a little bit, right pec? But today I'm feeling it with 235 plus 70 in chains. I was feeling it with an empty bar, and then I was feeling it with a plate, and then I was feeling it with just a band. So this is progress. All right, so I got the same weight on the bar to use the F8 shirt as I did with the catapult. Shouldn't touch, but I might get it to touch. But I want to just move this, see how it feels when they unwrap before I go up. I got a pretty good idea on what I want to hit today. I need good work to walk out of here safe. But I know what I want also. What I want and what I need are a little bit different. I may have to hook this to the shirt. Oh. Let's see here. That's going to be all up on my neck. Oh, buddy. Yeah, let's add some weight. That hurts so much less. Even in the catapult. Even on the unrack. You know, if you're benching to improve your log press, axle press, or whatever, you're having problems with stuff hurting on the raw. And then you get a catapult or slingshot or something like that, or bench daddy, and still have some kind of pain. Obviously, you need to focus on getting rid of the pain. But if you're not going to be raw anyway, no reason not to go with a shirt like this. You just use more weight. You just put more weight on the bar. So you just have to have an understanding that two plates with this shirt on is much different than two plates with a catapult on, which is much different than two plates raw. You can't compare them. If I get a good unwrap with my lats instead of my pecs and shoulders, it should be. Ooh. Oh, it's not set correctly at all. Definitely have more in me, obviously, but how safe is it? With the F8 shirt, it's an absolute great shirt. The biggest thing for me is there's always a point to where that shirt basically unwraps the weight for me. So you got to be ready. So I hit that point to where I cannot unwrap it myself. So once I get underneath the bar, I'm twisted almost like a tricep extension. And for me to get under the bar, it puts me in a really, really bad position. And to get into a good unrack position is just impossible. So I'm unracking it from kind of a tricep lockout. And at the last second, I try to shove my body under it and use the shirt to help me kind of bring the bar out. So it's not ideal. You don't get set up in the right spot. The press is easy. The unrack and the rack is not the safest thing in the world. And you can feel, if you've never benched one of these before, I mean, when I get set up, I've got to throw my arm over to get it into position, and I've got to stick it against that bar and grab, because it pulls you back in. You have to have a crazy strong upper back and rear delts to spread the shirt. You don't fit. It's not like wearing a regular shirt. This thing, it squeezes you forward like this the entire time. So you've got to have a strong upper back and rear delts. Mine gets sore every week that I use this just from spreading it like that. And the way it twists you, if you've ever gotten twisted up with a catapult, a slingshot, bench eddy like that, and went to press and your wrist kind of broke and the bar went back up over your face, this thing is much, much worse. If you're not careful, it gives you this little, you'll get a little wrist, boop, and that bar gets way out of path really, really fast. But it's a whole lot of fun. It's adding a couple extra turbochargers to your press, but you better be ready to control it, that's for sure. Triceps are worked, man. Front delts are worked, pecs are worked, upper back, rear delts are worked just from the light stuff that I did today. So that's accomplishment. And the thing is, I go back into what am I going to do to get better at this between now and next week? Me? Probably nothing, because bench press is not why I'm bench pressing. I actually enjoy bench pressing in a shirt. Really enjoy bench pressing in any shirt. I would do that every week just to get better at bench pressing in a shirt. And I do. I am. I do have a number, and I do have something that I want to hit in the shirt. But I'm doing this to get better at all my other pressing. So if you're having a training session like me, you come in here like, man, things were off. I messed up a couple times. What if I would have went to that last set and not been able to unrack it, not being able to get things correct? I just wasted a shirted training session. So what would I do between now and next week to get better? That's when it would really help to have a second bench press session during the week where you focused on speed, technique, all the stuff that I'm doing with deadlifts. You do it for all your exercises. Find a way to work on that technique. Repeated singles. Fix your weak spots. And then take another heavy something.